morning.
Good morning.
And Merry Christmas to you. Welcome to worship here today at St. Paul's this Christmas Day. Our readings for this day focus on the glory of the Lord. We got a glimpse of that glory in Luke chapter 2 last night as the angels announced what was happening in that lowly manger. And that glory of the Lord continues today in our lessons as we focus more so on the incarnation, the fact that it was the Word of God that was made flesh in that manger. How gracious is the Father to give us his Son for our salvation. We follow the order of service as it's printed for you in our service folder. Our opening hymn is hymn number 55, which the organ will play along with the brass. And on one of those verses, the brass plays alone, but you keep singing. It is one of the verses of the hymn. And then please stand for the final verse of that hymn. May God bless our worship today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known. He revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. That chosen night, when angels clove the sky with song and light, and God embodied love and sheathed his might, who could but gasp Emmanuel, who could but sing Emmanuel. And who could be the same for having held the infant in their arms and later felt the wounded hands and sighed all doubts dispelled? Who could but sigh, Emmanuel? Who could but shout, Emmanuel? Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music, with the harp and the sound of singing. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. Flesh and blood, you bore our griefs and pain. In bread and wine, you visit us again. Who could but see Emmanuel? Who could but thrill Emmanuel? How else could I have known you, O my God? How else could I have loved you, O my God? How else could I embrace you, O my God? Who could but pray, Emmanuel? Who could but praise, Emmanuel? The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, grant that the birth of your one and only Son in the flesh may set us free from our old bondage under the yoke of sin. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. First lesson is from the book of Exodus, chapter 33. Then Moses said to the Lord, "Now show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." But, he said, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live." Then the Lord said, "There is a place near me where you may stand on a rock. When my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen." Then the Lord came down in the cloud and stood there with him and proclaimed his name, the Lord. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, "The Lord, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation. This is the word of the Lord. A lesson from Hebrews chapter 1. In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my son, today I have become your father"? Or again, "I will be his father and he will be my son"? And again, when God brings his firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all God's angels worship him." In speaking of the angels, he says, "He makes his angels winds, his servants flames of fire." But about the Son, he says, "Your throne, O God, will last forever and ever, and righteousness will be the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has set you above your companions by anointing you with the oil of joy." This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the gospel lesson. The gospel according to John, chapter 1. Glory be to you, O Lord. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testifies concerning him. He cries out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' From the fullness of his grace, we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. You may be seated. We sing the hymn of the day, hymn number 35. Begotten ere the worlds began to be, He is Alpha and Omega, He the source, the ending, He of the things that are, that have been, and that future years shall see. Evermore and evermore. Oh, that birth forever blessed, when the Virgin full of grace, by the Holy Ghost conceiving, for the Savior of our race, and the babe, the world's Redeemer, first revealed His sacred face, evermore and evermore. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for our meditation this Christmas morning is a portion of the gospel lesson that I read to you a few moments ago, John chapter 1, verse 14, which I'll make reference to in the sermon. Dear friends, in our newborn King, if you wanted to sum up Christmas in one Bible passage, what would it be? If you don't want to go paging around in your Bible, maybe digging through Luke 2 or Matthew chapter 1, let me suggest John 1 verse 14. The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. That, my friends, is the essence of Christmas. There once was a man in a cave in Africa on December 25th. He was all by himself, no Christmas gathering with all the relatives. He had no gifts, no decorations, no music, no pile of food, not even a glass of eggnog. Could you imagine on Christmas? All he had was an old, torn-up Bible. But somehow he knew it was Christmas, and so he opened up his Bible to John 1:14 and read to himself, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us." And then he closed his Bible and prayed in his heart, "Thank you, God." In the meantime, there was a family in America. The house was decked out with every Santa decoration you can buy, all lit up. The house was packed with people, relatives you like and relatives you don't even care for. Bing Crosby was singing about snow and open fires on the home entertainment system. The table was covered with piles of food. Children were opening up one gift after another as the parents made small talk in the background. A good time was had by all. And then one by one, everyone went home. There was no mention of Jesus that night or the next morning. Nothing. Now, who really celebrated Christmas? The man in the cave pondering in his heart that the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us? Or the traditional jolly family gathering? Isn't it a blessing this morning that you don't have to sit by yourself in a cave somewhere with nobody around you? You don't have to worship God on your own. No, we can all be together today looking at this one verse. In the beginning was the infant Jesus, and the infant Jesus was with God, and the infant Jesus was God. He was with God in the beginning. When you think of it that way, isn't that amazing? Jesus existed long before what we call Christmas. Technically, Jesus wasn't born on Christmas. He simply became a human being on Christmas. Jesus existed long before he became a human. He was even around when? At the beginning of time? Well, sure, the infant Jesus was God. Do you know why the Gospel of John calls Jesus the Word? In Old Testament times, if you wanted to see God, well, where did you have to look? I want to see God. I'll look, well, at nature. Nature gives me somewhat of a picture of God. But for a real clear picture of God, I would have to look where? At the Word, the Old Testament. And they didn't have books back then, like we have today. In fact, most people didn't read. Most people would listen. If I wanted to see God, I would have to go to the temple or the synagogue, close my eyes and listen, and I would hear the Word of God. I would listen to the amazing stories, the gracious promises, the warnings, the blessings. Those words were how I saw God. But on Christmas, everything changed. The Word became flesh. Instead of being far away and distant, God gets up close and personal. He becomes human. Just think about that. If you wanted, you could jump on a plane, and I would suggest buying a ticket before you do something like that. And tomorrow, you could be standing on the same hill and look at the same views and splash in the same lake and river as the maker of heaven and earth splashed in and looked at and stood on. God became human. He stepped onto our planet, and he gave himself the name Jesus. Jesus is the only infant I know of who technically named himself. Before he was born, he sent the angel to tell Mary and Joseph what to name him. Have you ever thought about that before? This is what sets the Christian faith apart from all of the other false religions in the world. Only in Christianity does God come to his people and become human. In all the other religions of the world, God keeps his distance from them, demands things from them. But our God, he didn't just write us a letter or send us a representative, and he didn't come with his entourage to visit us. he actually became one of us. He spent 9 months in the womb, putting on the same human flesh that you and I are wearing right now. There once was a crazy old man. At least everyone thought he was crazy. He took care of a horse for a living, but that's not what made him crazy. Every winter, this man would lock himself out of the house and move into the barn with his horses. He'd sleep there, eat their food, drink their water. Could you imagine that? What would that be like? Like for one of you guys to try that sometime. But one day he had the courage to ask him why, people asked him why he did this every winter. And he told them, I wanted to know what it felt like to be a horse. And the point of that odd story is that this is what God did on Christmas. He locked himself out of heaven in a sense, threw away the key. Then he put on a human body and allowed himself to be born into a lowly peasant family. He even spent that first night of life sleeping in a stable for animals. God did that for you. Why? Well, it's because our world is a very dark place. It was a very dark place when Jesus arrived. And I'm not talking about it being nighttime. I'm talking about a world that is full of the darkness of sin. You know the story. You know how Adam and Eve brought that sin into the world. And ever since then, every single human being has been born with a sinful heart. There's an incredible amount of selfishness, of self-centeredness in our world. Have you noticed that? Have you seen some of that come out of your own heart at times? Deep down, every human being wants, in a way, to be God. I want to be in charge of my life. I want to trust in myself. I want to make money for myself and spend time with people that make me feel good about myself. And that's very self-centered, and that's sin. We all have it. The world is filled with it. Adam and Eve acted in a very self-centered way when they sinned many years ago. And what a moment that was. At that moment, the human race basically said to God, God, we don't want you to be our father anymore. We want to be on our own. And ever since then, the world has been a very dark place spiritually. Deep down, everyone knows that there's something wrong here. There's something missing in my life. I have a hole in my heart, and nothing seems to fill it. And whether people realize it or not, that hole is their relationship with God. People try to forget about that with decorating and snowmen and cookies and gifts, but that dark cloud won't go away. There's sin in our world. There's sin in my heart. Sin leads to death, and sin leads to hell. But dear friends, that's why God became human. That's why he stepped into our world. Look at verse 4 of the gospel lesson. In him, talking about Jesus, was life. And that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. You see, when God stepped into our world, it was as though a bright light had been turned on in a dark and dirty basement. Jesus, the light of the world, had come. And in him was something, the thing that was lacking in our world. And that something was life. Not physical life. There's plenty of that. That life that Jesus brought into the world was a deeper, more spiritual life. It's a relationship with God. That kind of a life. And Jesus brings that. Do you want to understand where you came from? And what the purpose of your existence is. That's life. And Jesus brings that to you. Do you want to have hope that these 70 or 80 years that you live on this planet isn't all that there is? That there's something more, something better? That's life. And Jesus brings it to you. So why did Jesus have to become flesh? Why couldn't Jesus or God just come down as a spirit and set up shop somewhere and everyone could come and listen to him and he could set us all straight? Well, God became flesh because as a human being, he had to do something to give you life. To give you life, he had to die. Isn't that awful? When a baby is born, you're not supposed to think about how this baby is going to die. And yet, when we look at the infant Jesus, you can't help but think about his death, because that's the number one reason he became human, so that he could take your sin. And we're not talking just about those little moments in your life when you make a small mistake. God became human so that he could take upon himself the darkest, the worst, the most horrible sins you have ever committed. And even that sinful nature that you inherited from your parents, Jesus was born to take that sin too. And 33 years roughly after his birth, to die with it, to die with all of it on the cross. That's why God became human. And look at what happened to all those who believe in the infant Jesus. Look what they would someday do. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. God makes you, through Christ, one of his very own children. Isn't that good news? God became part of our earthly family so that we could become a part of his heavenly family. Jesus took on our flesh and died with all of our sins so that you and I could someday rise from the dead with none of our sins. People say that Christmas is all about family, and it's kind of a meaningless cliche until you bring Jesus into the picture. Then Christmas is about family. Here, God becomes a part of our human family, so that we can become a part of his. So what's the passage that sums up Christmas best? Well, I say it's John 1:14. And as I read it to you again, think about this. In a way, Christmas is over. All the earthly stuff, it's got to be put away. The ads will show up starting tomorrow with exercise equipment so you can drop the pounds, and storage equipment so you can put away all the new stuff that you got. But John 14 tells us about something we can never put away. The part of Christmas that's the best part. The part that lasts all year long. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory. The glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. Please stand. We confess our Christian faith this Christmas day using excerpts from the Athanasian Creed as printed for you in the service folder. It is furthermore necessary for eternal salvation truly to believe that our Lord Jesus Christ also took on human flesh. Now this is the true Christian faith. We believe and confess that our Lord Jesus Christ, God's Son, is both God and man. He is God, eternally begotten from the nature of the Father, and he is man, born in time from the nature of his mother. Fully God, fully man, with rational soul and human flesh, equal to the Father as to his deity, less than the Father as to his humanity. And though he is both God and man, Christ is not two persons, but one. One, not by changing the deity into flesh, but by taking the humanity into God. One, indeed, not by mixture of the natures, but by unity in one person. For just as the rational soul and flesh are one human being, so God and man are one Christ. He suffered for our salvation, descended into hell, rose the third day from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and from there will come to judge the living and the dead. At his coming, all people will rise with their own bodies to answer for their personal deeds. Those who have done good will enter eternal life, but those who have done evil will go into eternal fire. This is the true Christian faith. Whoever does not faithfully and firmly believe this cannot be saved. You may be seated. During the offering, please fill out the friendship register that you find in the pew, usually along the aisle side, and pass it down to those sitting next to you. Please stand for prayer. On this holy day, dear Father, we rejoice to hear the good news of great joy that a Savior has been born for us. For fulfilling your prophecies and in the fullness of time sending your Son to be our Savior, we give you our heartfelt thanks and praise. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. What a great mystery of our faith this is, that God has become fully human for our salvation. Even though he is the all-powerful Lord of all, he is wrapped in strips of cloth and lying in a manger. Help us always believe that this precious child was born as our substitute to be our Savior. In the midst of our joy, we grieve for the many people in our world who do not know that Jesus has come to bring them forgiveness and healing. As the shepherds spread abroad the good news of the birth of the Savior born for all the world, may we also make use of the unique opportunities this holiday presents to tell others of what we have seen and heard concerning the child. Grant that the true peace between God and fallen mankind may comfort all people. Hear us, Lord, as we bring you our private petitions. As the angels sang out their praise, move us also to sing out our praise to you today and every day, as the joy of Christmas remains in our hearts. Glory to God in the highest. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who has called us to be his own, so that we may live under him in his kingdom and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Holy Father, in the beginning you spoke and created light, but we loved the darkness of sin and unbelief. When the time had fully come, you sent your Son to be a light for those walking in darkness and in the shadow of death. We praise you and give you thanks that Jesus, the eternal Word, became flesh and made his dwelling among us, that born of a woman, born under law, he lived without sin as our substitute, that as the Lamb of God, he suffered and died to take away the sin of the world, that he rose from death and lives forever to proclaim peace to all. As the shepherds came to the manger, we now approach your altar with reverent joy. Here we find our Savior, Christ the Lord, who gives us his body and blood for forgiveness and peace. Through this meal, bring us life and light. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Please stand. We give you thanks, O Lord, for the foretaste of the heavenly banquet that you have given us to eat and to drink in this sacrament. Through this gift, you have fed our faith, nourished our hope, and strengthened our love. By your Spirit, help us to live as your holy people until that day when you will receive us as your guests at the wedding supper of the Lamb, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated. Our final hymn is hymn 57, Go Tell It on the Mountain. Good morning. Merry Christmas. I want to say welcome to our guests that are worshiping with us on this Christmas day. If you didn't get an opportunity to sign or fill out our friendship register yet, please do so before you leave, and we hope that you can come and worship with us again. I'd like to say thank you to all of our participants over these Christmas services, our musicians, organists, pianists, and so forth. A lot of work behind the scenes to get all those things ready, and we're grateful for all the work that they put in, not only serving their God and Savior, but also serving us as well. In the bulletin today, I put in there, starting on page 14, our Wells Together newsletter. There may be some things of interest in there to you. One is the update on the One in Christ offering, which you may remember is meant to pay off the $4.7 million debt that our synod still owes. It's an update of the progress. We've raised $500,000 already, and we still haven't discussed yet, even in our congregation, how we might participate in that offering. Many of you ask me about this, and there's an update also on page 14. Doctrinal discussions continue between the CLC, the Church of the Lutheran Confessions, the ELS, and the Wells. You might be interested in reading about the progress between those groups. And then also congregations reaching out with the video, My Son, My Savior. Information there about how some congregations have done it. We in our congregation handed out 200 of those at our Jordan Dazzle Parade earlier this year, also containing information about our church. But you can see what other congregations have done to also use My Son, My Savior as a way to reach out. On behalf of my family, I'd like to wish all of you, again, a very Merry Christmas. If you're traveling, that God may go with you and keep you safe. And God's blessings to you into the new year.
Thank you. Yeah.